Get a podcast sponsor. Well, four people have to drink it. Only one person can't drink it.
One, two, three, four. Got it.
Turn it up. Well, thank you for having us. We've enjoyed it.
Thank you for being here.
All right. Peace, buddy.
All right. Can you bring a fishbowl in here for me?
Hey, everybody. We're doing a live broadcast. I guess I'll be scared.
Introduce her yet, but she's talking.
She's ready.
I talk out of turn a lot.
She is the unofficial mayor of Atlanta.
Just roll with it.
Anything that happens, you have to go through her.
Yes.
She is the queen of politics after dark.
Yes.
Kirsten. Daniel, no S. Who has been kind enough to have us here at the Moon Bar.
Yes.
Talk to us a little bit about what you do and what's going on in the Atlanta area.
The M Bar on Auburn Avenue.
Hey,
Hey, y'all.
Hey.
I say y'all because I'm from Atlanta, so I like a little Southern twang. So my name is Kirsten Daniel with no S. I make sure to emphasize that because that's
like a totally different person.
Yeah, man, that's okay. A totally different family.
Gotcha.
But yeah, I'm Kirsten Daniel. I am a celebrity lifestyle manager.
Right.
If I must explain that, that would be best explained as a person that tells people what to do, celebrities what to do. So that's kind of like the goodness of my job. I have a good opportunity to work with a lot of really, really cool people, a lot of business people, a lot of artists, and I just tell them what to do all day, and it's pretty great.
Does that get difficult? Because we've worked with some celebs, and they're not the easiest.
It's not easy, but okay. You know, I got a little bark on me, so you know.
But you're little. I wouldn't expect a bark.
Yeah. I let people get away with a lot, but after a certain amount of time, my bark is a little. My bark is real strong.
Right.
Yeah, I've been doing that for about 6 years, and my position here at MBAR is to work as the ambassador of Politics After Dark, which is our Thursday night here. So it's really cool because we get to meet a lot of really, really cool, good-looking people like you guys. Every Thursday, y'all come, y'all kick it, y'all turn up with us, and we just talk, man, and we have good drinks and good food. And we're so happy to have you guys here. It's Thursday.
How did you get this thing started? Like, what made you say, I want to do a Politics After Dark?
Well, this is actually Xavier People's brainchild.
Okay.
So he approached me maybe last year when they were talking about doing something like this because of our affiliation in another organization called the Influencer Coalition. So with that, we have a lot of social activism that we do in the community. So because he knew my affiliation with the community and my involvement with the entertainment business, he thought it would be a good merger, you know, for us to do here on Thursday night.
I want to talk a little bit about the location. This is the new MR.
The new MBAR.
Okay, so what comes with the new MBAR? What is new? What is improved? What's going on here?
Oh, new and improved. First of all, the menu is fantastic.
Okay.
Foods?
The food is amazing. I don't know if you guys had those jerk turkey burgers, but they are banging.
Okay.
The drink menu, have you guys seen that? My favorite drink is the Choke Chop. I don't know if you guys.
Choke Chop?
Choke Chop.
Choke Chop.
Yeah.
Like Box?
That's an amazing drink. It's an amazing drink. The names are crazy, but the drinks are great.
Who orders more chochas, ladies or men?
I don't know about that. I'd have to say
ladies.
It was probably ladies.
Like ladies. Chocha,
but it's a Ciroc. It's a Ciroc drink, and it has like some type of God sent lemonade in it that just makes it feel like, you know, you and your mama's kitchen. It's so good. So yeah, the drink menu is fantastic. The food is incredible. We have DJ on Thursday night. We have a DJ. You guys may have heard him by the name of Ryan Michael Cox, who is incredible. So he rocks out with us on Thursday nights. But we just have a good time here. The vibe is amazing.
You don't have to be done.
They're never done.
So what do we like to talk about on Politics After Dark? What is the political or politics thing on your mind right now?
I
want to
hear you guys' opinion about last night's mess up of debate. I want to hear what you guys think about that.
Well,
since we're Politics After Dark, let's start there.
I just got slun. Our managing editor, Jemaine Bolden, is here, and she's like, Danny, did you even watch it? Well, actually, I didn't. You're absolutely right. I attempted to watch it. GOP debate. I fell asleep about halfway through. I saw some highlights. I saw Trump acting a fool, getting his Trump on, as always.
I mean, that's what I was going to say. Like, even if you didn't watch it, you know what is going to happen. You know what they're there for. Like, it's a circus. It's a show. Like, and that's what they did. They let Donald Trump talk all of his stuff and, you know, make a fool of himself and all that kind of thing. So I feel like if you saw the first one, then you saw all you needed to see.
I want to talk about a few things that happened last night.
Talk about it, Nick.
Okay. The most important thing to me that happened was Jeb Bush.
I did see this.
Telling Donald Trump to apologize
to his wife.
Oh.
And Donald Trump didn't apologize.
Because he's an asshole.
No. That don't follow. That does not follow on Donald Trump.
No.
That falls on Jeb Bush.
So,
if you ask somebody to apologize to your wife, you cannot come home
unless that apology has
been given. So what would you have done as the only married person on this podcast? What would you have done
I don't know if the, audio caught that, but there was a lot of, they were sad. No, don't leave, lady. Don't leave. I see you going towards the door. Don't leave. Stay here. We're still, John's eligible, so I'm fine.
Not really.
Okay, never mind. So anyway,
all they have is me.
Danny's eligible.
I'm your only option, sorry.
So look. If a guy, if you demand that a guy apologize to your wife, you can't go home unless he says, I'm sorry. Like Jeb Bush should have delivered a fade. Does nobody agree that they should have fought?
How can you deliver the fade at a GOP?
That would have made me mad to miss
it. Because it's your wife. Your wife is more important than running the country to oblivion.
Because
you still gotta get some when you come home.
That's very true.
And you still gotta get some in the White House. Like, I don't care what kind of trees you sign in, if you're not coming home to some butt.
what are we really
what are you doing?
What are we really doing?
You should have delivered the faith.
Well, I will say, so I did not catch the entire debate because it was boring as hell. But what I did see after I woke up and I refreshed from my nap, I saw Hillary Clinton on Jimmy Fallon. Did anyone see Hillary on Jimmy Fallon last night? Anybody? Bueller? No. Nobody saw Hillary but me. I'm the only black person who watched Fallon.
Was she whipping and was she naked?
She was not hitting that stick. Not this time, but she has before. She was on Fallon. And we've talked about this before. Hillary Clinton just has no cool factor whatsoever. Like we will never get a president as cool as Barack Obama again. Genuinely
true. True that.
Hillary does not have that. She was up there in a pantsuit.
But I thought she was going to have that. Maybe I just drunk the pool. I thought she was going to come out and people were going to be hyped.
That's her husband. She's not her husband.
I just thought it was going to be hyped for Hillary. She had a chance to actually win. I thought they were going to get out.
So Hillary was there on Fallon. I took notes. Copious notes just for you guys because I care.
I appreciate that.
So here are some highlights. She said she wanted to reduce student loan interest rates, and she wanted to have free public college, which is great.
That's cool.
If you're like me, you're drowning in debt, from student loans, great. But then she also tried to tell a story, and it was just real awkward. Fallon was trying to help her out, and he was like, tell them about that time you were at the White House and people didn't know it was you and they asked you to take a picture.
We gave her a shot to try to be cool.
And it didn't work. It just felt
cool. I just want to bring it back to Donald Trump real quick.
Okay, come on, Xavier.
And maybe I'm a little bit too serious, but I just want to ask y'all a question.
Go ahead.
What does it say about our country that the front runner for the Republican Party is racist, xenophobic, misogynistic, and any other type of adjective that is probably negative, self-absorbed, narcissistic, right, flaunts his money. Like, where have we gone or where have we come as a country that people really support this guy and really want, somebody really wants this guy to be the president of our country?
That's very true, because there were people backing him up and clapping the whole time.
That's like, right. Woo! And whether we realize it or not, let's just say, what if Donald Trump actually wins the nomination? And then what if he goes up against, let's just say, Hillary Clinton, and he wins?
Right
now, that's a real possibility.
Right.
And that's something that we all need to really think about. Speaking of Hillary Clinton, let's just say Hillary Clinton wins the nomination. Okay. Right now, people aren't really excited about Hillary Clinton.
At all. They're waiting for Joe to say he's going to do his thing.
That's right. And I would argue that the best thing that could ever happen to Hillary Clinton is for Donald Trump to win the nomination.
Yep.
Because people will vote against Donald Trump instead of voting for Hillary Clinton.
Hopefully.
So I want to ask that question to the panel today. What do you all think about our country that Donald Trump is actually the front runner and people are actually taking this guy serious at this point?
I think it says a lot. It says, like you said, we're at a place now where there are literally people who are so out of it, out of touch with reality, that they would actually think that someone like Trump could run our country. It just speaks to where we are as a country. It's crazy. It's bizarre. It's like we're in another world right now.
So I want to talk about that. Donald Trump is essentially, he's the Frankenstein monster. That Fox News created this audience of people who are so right-wing that they hate black people, they hate immigrants, they hate anybody who's basically not a white male, even though most of the people who watch Fox News are receiving the same sort of government care and government funding that they accuse the minorities and immigrants are taking from them. So they created this audience of people who are thirsting for so much right-wing racism that when they get this guy who's so over-the-top saying the things that Fox News sort of dances around, they're surprised that they have a guy who gets that audience. So basically, Donald Trump is a reflection of how racist America is. I mean, just a couple days ago, this young Middle Eastern brother, Muslim brother, gets arrested for having a clock in his classroom. Like, these are the people who are voting for Donald Trump. And these people have always been here, but it's the first time that they've actually had somebody who is not afraid to be as racist as they are. So that's where we are in this country, but like, I mean, this is really one of those pivotal points. If I can get into a little history.
Go ahead, drop some knowledge on it.
Like if we're thinking about what caused the abolition of slavery, right? There was an abolitionist movement who was so left that they were not able to win the presidential election, but they got enough of the block of the vote where people said, hey, let me go ahead, or Lincoln was like, let me go ahead and go on, you know, part of getting rid of slavery and I won the presidency.
Right.
That's essentially what Donald Trump is. He's so on the opposite, so right, that he's gonna get a certain block of the vote to where there'll be the people coming after him will say, I'm gonna be as right-wing and racist as him, just a little bit more moderate, and think they're gonna win in 2020 or 2024 when Hillary's
done. I mean, he's the polar opposite of Barack Obama. So I mean, that's first thing first. Like, people who don't look at Obama and think he had a good presidency, or think he's a good president, or think he knows what he's doing, he's the polar opposite of that. And on top of all of that, people are just skeptical of politics at this point. I mean, I think that's a large part of what it's part of what he's bringing. Now, those people that you just talked about that are so far to the right, that's what they're on. Like, that's anything that looks like that, they're kind of with that. I mean, I think he probably reminds them more of George Bush than anybody else who's running against the Republican side of things. But even more than that, it's like he's entertained. And it's like, you know, where's the country at? The country wants to be entertained. Like, that's where we're at with it. The country wants to watch a good show. The country wants to see a good trend. The country wants to see, you know, somebody do something crazy. Like Donald Trump on TV is somebody doing something crazy every single day, every single night. Right?
So I want to talk about a prediction. If it's not Trump or the Republicans, who do we think is going to be?
Slim Jesus. Slim Jesus is gonna be the Republican candidate.
What about the Carly?
Carly.
I like her.
She's not terrible. She's not terrible. She was the only one up there that I thought actually kind of held her own against Trump.
I want to take a break real quick because Danny's talking. And Danny has brought a cavalcade of ladies with her. All the AKAs, can you give me a big SKWWWE real quickly? They're all congregating.
There's some
deltas here. It sounds like there's some deltas here.
That's
so nice. That just gave me flashbacks to all the time that I was denied on the dates.
All the times I didn't get text back, all the DMs
that went unpopping. That was all over. Anyway, we have just had a drink delivered to our table. Is this the fishbowl drink?
Yes, it is. Break that down.
It's a mystery there, man.
You need a
mystery. So we don't know what's in the drink.
I'm about to see you at the top.
That's all I'm gonna say.
Okay, so I'm gonna read what's in the drink.
All right, let's go. We're gonna get a read of what's in.
What's it called first and foremost? Is this called the fishbowl?
Face down.
Face down. Wait,
face
what?
Face down,
down
in a mason jar.
This is called down. Face down.
It used to be called face down in a fishbowl.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Face down in a mason jar.
Okay, so it is a silver tequila.
Silver tequila.
Cointreau. Is that how you say that?
Cointreau?
I don't know.
Okay.
You know what you mean.
Cointreau.
Watermelon snaps.
Watermelon snaps.
White peach snaps.
White
peach snaps. And fresh caper lime.
A lot of lady water.
Okay, all right.
A lot of what?
A lot of lady water.
I'm going to say that.
Oh, okay, wait. I'm sorry. Wrong one. Same ingredients with chilled organic frozen peaches. Pineapples and mango.
Oh, with fresh fruit in it.
Okay,
yeah.
right.
And this is a 32-ounce drink.
Okay.
Only the strong will survive.
I'm just going to say that when the lady brought the drink, she was wearing gloves.
She had a hazmat suit on. That's how you know it's really the real deal. Awesome.
Yeah, so I want to talk about anything else from the debates that they were offering handshakes.
That was the most awkward handshake in the world. That's why I didn't see it. It wasn't even a high five.
You know, there were Ben Carson was there.
Oh, he's terrible.
His wife, I saw his wife.
She's terrible.
What's his wife look like?
They said his wife looked like Mama Clump. They said his wife looked like Billy Goat of some sort. They say something like she has those little peppermint mints that look like the watermelon wrapper. She has those in her purse.
it's like
she on the buzzer board and all that stuff. Alright. Yeah, drinks gonna be happening. So Donald Trump gave Ben Carson the like, hey, I like black people high five, which was cool.
Was it cool?
It was cool. You didn't like the high five?
Yeah.
You know, Ben Carson,
Ben Carson
hates black people.
Yeah, he does. He's putting us straight back to slavery.
Now, why would you say that Ben Carson hates?
He called Black Lives Matter like the Wu-Tang Clan or something.
He called them like bullies.
But so, which is sad because, you know, the movie with Mos Def, wasn't that him?
No.
That was him?
That was him?
What?
Didn't Mos Def play Ben? Who did he play?
Yeah. That wasn't him.
I think it was.
There was Cuba Gooding Jr. in the play.
Yeah.
He was in another movie, another doctor. Yeah, John Hopkins. It was another doctor. Yeah.
Mos Def.
Not Mos Def.
Okay.
All right.
I don't know. I
think it was Cuba. Yeah.
So Cuba Gooding Jr. played Ben Carson.
Yeah.
That makes so much sense.
Yeah. Now it's really coming together.
I saw Cuba Gooding Jr. is gonna play Oga. Slim Jesus is a Caucasian rapper from Ohio.
Ohio.
Who looks like Eminem.
Yeah.
Raps like Chief Keef.
Absolutely.
And had a video with machine guns in it.
Talk about this disclaimer with
those. And he had a disclaimer.
Yeah. A hardcore rap video with a disclaimer.
Because basically he was like, I'm white, don't take me to jail.
Right.
He was like, these are just my N-word friends.
Right, yeah.
And
I don't really know these guys.
Send them to jail, but I'm white and things might happen to me in jail. So Slim Jesus, in not